Our SAU news reporters are out on campus covering the latest news.
I'm Natasha Mirilov here at the old CK's, which was once a student's favorite dining area. Find out why it was closed and how other eateries are being affected.
You can use your phone during this week of prayer. We caught your reactions on yik-yaking during convocation.
Also, joining us in the studio is communications professor Tara Hargrove. We'll talk about the new social app.
Coming up on SAU News, updates to the crosswalks and at the Holsey Wellness Center and the Village Market. Find out about new crosswalks coming in more on SAU News. So, stop, look both ways, and get ready because SAU News starts now.
Welcome to SAU News. I'm Kendall Rittenauer.
And I'm Georgia Standish. SAU News is a weekly newscast brought to you by the School of Journalism and Communication. The motion-activated warning lights at campus crosswalks have been deactivated. Pedestrians must now manually activate the warning lights. SAU News reporter Ben Lowry talked to Campus Safety about the issue.
Campus Safety has made changes to the crosswalks at the Holsey Wellness Center and the Village Market. I'm here at the Village Market crosswalk. You may have noticed some changes here. The motion sensors are no longer active. You have to press the button, look both ways to cross, just as you have to do at every other crosswalk. So, be smart. Cars, they can be distracted as well. Don't be on your cell phone, don't be looking around, don't be looking at that. Communication major Debbie Hall does not miss the automated flashers.
I guess the lights are pretty good considering most, unless people don't use it.
New signs have been placed in the center of the crosswalks and on the pole to remind pedestrians to push the button to cross and look both ways. Campus Safety Officer Brooks Kirschman explains why the flashers are activated manually.
We're having a lot of students and just pedestrians cross the crosswalks without stopping and making eye contact with drivers. They're just darting out into the road. Can't always guarantee that a driver is going to be able to see the pedestrian entering the crosswalk area, so trying to do it for student safety and also to try to help drivers being able to see the pedestrians.
I appreciate that flashing light.
The flashers do help, you know, tell you the amount of traffic through there.
Some people I know are talking on their phones too much and that can distract them. Mm-hmm.
So, be smart, have some common sense, and always look both ways. Reporting for SAU News, I am the Ben Lowry.
Thanks, Ben. Campus Safety will install two new manual crosswalks in front of Southern Village and Thatcher South in a couple weeks.
All this week during Week of Prayer, we've been encouraged to use our phones. This is a big change for most convocations where phone usage is usually discouraged. I had a chance to ask students what they thought about this exception.
The nightly meetings this year are titled Fall at the Wall, only it wasn't held at the wall opening night.
Despite the clear skies today, Fall at the Wall has been moved to the church due to rainfall this morning. The theme is purity, and tonight's topic is dating.
The presenter, Heather Thompson Day, addressed the topic of dating by sharing her personal story and then pointed students to the Holy Spirit as the best source of counsel.
If we are to pray for anything, let it be for the anointing of the Holy Spirit.
Students were encouraged to give feedback during the meetings on social media, including the sometimes controversial Yik-Yak.
There are some in our midst that like to yak. This week, my friends, is your time to yak. Here's what we're doing. Here's what we do. Yakking, tweeting, Facebook. We want to solicit your responses.
Yik-Yak, oh man, it's just so many things are going on. Yik-Yak.
I know, people are on Yik-Yak. I was one of them. And some people are bringing up really good points, like ideas and definitely questions I feel like Campus Ministries wants to talk about and issues that they want to raise.
I think it's a good idea because people actually speak their mind, and that's pretty rare nowadays, especially with like Twitter, Facebook. You have your picture attached to what you're saying, so it's really censored.
I guess that's like the most recent social media right now, so I guess it's effective if everyone uses it.
Well, we've heard what students think of the latest social media craze on campus. For a different perspective, we've invited a communication professor to join us in the studio.
Tara Hargrove teaches communication studies here in the School of Journalism and Communication. Her courses include persuasion and propaganda and public speaking. Professor Hargrove, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
So unlike Facebook and Twitter, Yik-Yak allows you to post anonymously. What's your experience been?
Well, my first experience has been with students who have shown me posts that were inappropriate and they were upset about these posts, but I've also been shown some very positive things that were where students were supporting each other and positive things like that. So,
as we saw in Kendall's report, Campus Ministries has been soliciting anonymous questions via Yik-Yak. Have you been surprised by that decision?
I was actually there, and I was quite shocked that they were utilizing that, but I could see that there's some potential there, possibly.
Now, Yik-Yak is being criticized by college administrators for being explicit and negative, even a threat to safety. Norwich University in Vermont banned the app from their campus computer network. How do you think Southern should respond to this?
I can see that there are some issues there, but I think that what we need to keep in mind is that this is the freedom of speech and censorship, and we want to be careful that we're not doing either of those, or that we are keeping freedom of speech and not censoring that. So I think it's important to allow that communication to happen. I think it can be positive. I can see how it can be negative also. We also want to make sure that we're not using it in a propaganda type of way, that organizations are not going in and posing as students or individuals with an agenda that they have within the app.
Do you think Yik-Yak is a revolutionary tool or just a passing fad?
I think it could be quite revolutionary as far as a communication tool where students can ask questions anonymously that maybe they're afraid or embarrassed to ask in any other way, and that students can help each other just as it was designed. So I think it could be quite revolutionary, yes.
Professor Hargrove, I'm sure this opens up a wide range of research opportunities for your students.
It certainly could.
Thanks for sharing your insights.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
But what do you think of Yik-Yak? We'd like to hear from you. Tweet us your comments at our Twitter address you see on the screen, at SAU News Now.
Once again, find us on Twitter, at SAU News Now. We may post your comment in next week's show. The School of Education and Psychology has moved back into its original building. After 3 years of remodeling, Summerour is once again open for business. The university funded the $4 million project with help from the Summerour family and other donors. The building's original structure was preserved, but more than 7,000 square feet was added. It has several new features, including an elevator, motion-activated lights, an expanded teacher material center, and a 70-inch touchscreen in the lobby. The updated TMC includes a library, activities for children, and big windows with one of the best views on campus.
The campus kitchen was one of students' favorite eateries on campus. SAU News reporter Natasha Mirilov found out why administration decided to shut it down.
The campus kitchen closure has been a big disappointment to many returning students.
That is, so many words. It makes me so mad.
Administration closed the CK to create a training kitchen for culinary arts students. Former CK manager Shirley Manhannett says she was surprised at the news.
Doug Prude came to me a week before school was out last year and told me that the culinary school needed space. And since the CK was moving to the new student center, they felt like that the culinary school should have that space.
Food service director Greg Cook says the university had a choice between refurbishing the kitchen or giving the space to the culinary school.
And we were going to have to change the format anyway, but why would we want to invest $500,000, $1 million of students' money when we're going to close in 2 years anyway?
University officials say that all eateries on campus, apart from KR's, will be moved to the new Student Life Center to be built right here between the Halsey Wellness Center and the Village Market. Once the university breaks ground, construction will take 2 years.
Food that was previously served at the CK is now being offered at the Village Market Deli, the Snack and Wagon, and KR's. To compensate for the lack of seating, KR's has expanded into the Student Center lobby and the patio. The VM has added more tables outside. KR Supervisor Yolanda Akshay says her staff is under more pressure to serve quickly without the CK on campus.
And then there's the other pressure of also doing well so that we don't get closed down.
One thing we'll all miss are the cheaper menu items once available at the CK.
We made money for the school. We had the prices for the students was affordable.
Food service officials say new changes in the meal pricing have made CAF food more affordable. For SAU News, I'm Natasha Mirilov.
The university dedicated the land for the new student center this week. The official groundbreaking will be next spring.
The Southern Accent reports the Isles PE Center is getting a new PA system. Installation of the new digital mixing board and speakers begins next week. Students should notice a difference, especially better amplified music in the gym, including stronger bass sounds. Later this fall, contractors will install acoustic panels to cut down on the reverberation.
Latin music and cuisine were front and center at this year's Latin American Club Night. As I discovered last weekend, it was a night to honor Hispanic immigrants who now call America home. Community members gathered with Southern faculty and students in Isles PE Center for a night of fun. LAC, the Latin American Club, hosted guests with food from different countries. Mexico, Cuba, and the Dominican Republic were represented, but Puerto Rico was Jonathan Gonzalez's favorite.
Well, the pupusas was really good. It's really good. And the Puerto Rican food, just because I'm Puerto Rican, so.
The mariachi band behind me is just bringing the Latin American culture to LAC Night, and students from Southern are cycling through these different booths and sampling the cuisine right now.
LAC President Giovanna Ruiz explained the event's theme, Coming to America.
Being in America in itself is difficult for us Hispanics, and having that one night a year to just celebrate the fact that we are Latin American and that we are Hispanic, it's a pride culture thing.
Members of LAC performed an original play following the meal. The actors showed what it's like for Latin Americans immigrating to the U.S., but with a humorous twist. Musicians also performed periodically throughout the play. The evening ended with a special song written about the popular Hispanic spice, adobo. LAC is always creative with its events. Even without cultural dancing, the night definitely had Latin flair.
It really did. The streets of Chattanooga's emerging Southside neighborhood became the classroom for students in digital photography last week. Class members were on assignment shooting urban portraits. Seasoned wedding photographer Garrett Nudd was their guide, offering tips on the best way to light and pose subjects. Nudd himself, a Southern alum, has taught the class for a short 2-week intensive for several years. Nudd's Cobblestone Rue Gallery and Studio is located nearby on East Main Street. Students will use the images of their final portfolio due later this fall.
And this year, futsal is back again. At the end of last semester, students were notified that this year, futsal would be replaced with reversed volleyball. This decision was made when the department wanted to give volleyball players, just like soccer players, a chance to play in both semesters. Intramural director Troy Walker says that after hearing a lot of disappointment from the soccer fans, both sports are now offered at the same time.
And I was really disappointed when I heard that we weren't going to have it. I played for the first time last year, and it was a lot of fun, so I'm really looking forward to it this year.
According to Walker, intramurals is about getting students to participate in the sports they enjoy. The department is still deciding whether keeping both sports ongoing at the same time is efficient enough for future years. If you're interested in watching, futsal is in the gym on Tuesday and Thursday nights.
Coming up next week on SAU News, emergency responders and local police and fire departments invite students to celebrate America's National Night Out Against Crime. It's a non-threatening way to meet that officer who might be writing your next speeding ticket.
and listen for the crack of the bat. We'll bring you the cheers and jeers from Southern's all-night softball tournament.
SAU News is a joint production of the TV News and multi-camera production class here in the School of Journalism and Communication. I'm Kendall Rittenauer.
And I'm Georgia Standish. See you next week.